So getting your opening right is critical. This is true if you're trying to write a book. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. Now imagine if Charles Dickens started the book. Things were really hard back then, but you know, it wasn't so bad. They were also good. Yeah, it's not quite the same, right? This is why people work so hard on their pickup line when they're trying to get a date, because you only have one chance to make that impression. Hey, my name is Will. God's Will, you know? Wow, I didn't believe in predestination until I met you. I think John Calvin used that one on his wife. Or you can just use one that King Solomon used in the Song of Songs. Your hair is like a flock of goats descending from Gilead. You know, just saying, right? First lines are important. They catch your attention. They also direct your attention. One of the best known and most important compositions in classical music begins mysteriously and majestically. You know it. Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. Those simple notes arouse a world of emotions and expectations, used in movies, commercials, in all sorts of settings. They direct your attention to what is about to come. Now, for someone steeped in the scriptures, as John certainly was, there can be no grander way of beginning his gospel, no better way to catch attention as well as to direct attention than to begin, "In the beginning was the Word." John, with those words, arouses our emotions, raises our expectations, as if there were and is going to be a story told that is so momentous that it could be described as nothing short of a regenesis, a recreation. So as we come to start this series on the Gospel of John, we want to do so on this note of expectation, that over the course of the year, as we explore the stories of Jesus, his work, and the lives of disciples back then and even now, his work of recreating back then and even now, we have a world of emotions, expectations that ought to be stoked, shaped, directed. I want to invite us to take a moment to pray that God would raise your expectations for what he could be doing in your lives. And no matter what the reality is that you might find yourselves in, no matter what set of circumstances that seem to be the dominating reality of your life, that you would hear God's tune in this gospel, resetting the parameters of your life. Let's pray. God, we do come to you recognizing that we have all sorts of circumstances that swirl around us. Some of them very happy circumstances as we start a new year. We're eager to make friends, get involved. Some of us are confronting very difficult and unhappy circumstances, wondering when in the world we're going to get out from underneath them. Regardless of where we may be in life, we pray that we would hear your tune and that our lives would be caught up in it. Set our lives to the music of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now, all the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they generally fit in this category called Greco-Roman biography. Historical accounts that were written in order to, well, teach some kind of moral lesson. Mark opens up his gospel with the ministry of John the Baptist. Matthew pushes the story back a little further in history and opens with a genealogy beginning with Abraham. Luke Well, he wants to put the historical details of his gospel even further back. And he starts his genealogy not with Abraham, but with Adam and Eve. John, however, he has this penchant for drama, I guess. He launches his gospel with a reference to the beginning that goes back to time immemorial, a genealogy of God himself. And the significance of Jesus was not only in the telling of historical details about his life, but the historic significance of his life. And of course, John was concerned about the historical details, the details that shaped his earthly ministry. But he was perhaps even more concerned about the historic significance, the eternal, transcendent importance of the Son of God that came into time and space and was the historical Jesus. And so he had a deep concern for history, historical details. John writes with attention to these details. He provides even more geographical markers than the other gospels. Whereas the other gospels simply say that Jesus was baptized at the Jordan, John specifies where in the Jordan. It was in the Jordan near the city of Bethany. John also describes the healing of the paralytic, and he goes into great detail that this took place near the Sheep Gate at the Pool of Bethesda, surrounded by five colonnades. It was popular in the former century to think that John, because of his poetic beginning to the gospel, really wasn't concerned about history, that in fact he wasn't a very good historian. He was a really good poet, a really good theologian, but not a very good historian. And they would bring up details like, well, we have no idea where this five-colonnade pool is, no record of it. And then lo and behold, a couple of decades ago, it was discovered. John proves to be meticulous with the details of history. He is historical. But even more importantly, he's historic. He wants to situate Jesus in all his historical details into his historic importance. In the beginning. Yeah, he could start his story a myriad of ways. And he wants to situate what happened 2,000 years ago and the coming of Jesus. He wants to situate it into the eternal purposes of God. That however you are to understand Jesus, you have to understand him in this grand picture. Before the manger in Bethlehem, before the shepherds in the field, before the visiting of the Magi. What we have in this gospel is the story of God himself. And with this language of the prologue, John evokes emotions, the deepest symbolisms of Scripture. If I started out a message saying 47 years ago, you would recognize that allusion to Lincoln's great speech at Gettysburg. And it would start to evoke emotions and expectations. Oh, and this is a message about maybe sacrifice that needs to be made in the pursuit of freedom and liberation for the oppressed. Or maybe I could begin by saying one small step for man, hearkening back to Armstrong's words, landing on the moon. And you might expect a message that deals with the great leaps of faith that saints can take in trusting God. Here, John wants to put the whole story in context, in the grand context of what God has always intended from the beginning of time. He has this eye for the historian's significance, but he also has the mind of the theologian, a mind that makes these brilliant spirit-filled connections in Scripture. Genesis, in the beginning. It opens up with the scene. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was formless and void. Darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. Now, of course, this is not a sermon, and we're not going to do a series on Genesis, but we need to make note of what the Genesis account is about in order to grasp what John is after here, to appreciate what John is saying about Jesus. The description of the earth as formless and void in Genesis Well, it's a translation in English of this wonderfully poetic Hebrew phrase. In Hebrew, it's tohu vavohu. It's kind of this rhyming compound phrase that indicates chaos. It's what we do with English when we say something like, oh man, I was running helter-skelter. Or I was going pell-mell from one class to the next. I mean, it's just this rhyming set of words that describe chaos that you might be involved in. By beginning this way, John says, there is chaos. There is chaos in this world. There is tohu vavohu. There is helter-skelter, pell-mell, that we run from one thing after the next, not quite sure how all the pieces of our lives fit together. And yet, in the middle of that, God's act of creation is to bring order. The story of Jesus is the story of God showing up to deal with our tohu vavohu. And he deals with it by speaking the word, a self-disclosure of God's character and nature, which we would otherwise never know. Things about God's character, things about God's purposes that only can be known if he chooses to tell them to us. Jesus doesn't merely reveal the words of God. He is the word that reveals God. We could not know God apart from him. To know Jesus is to know God. And so he speaks a word into our tohu vavohu, into the chaos of our lives, that reveals, that discloses his purpose, his very nature. And in disclosing that, he reveals to us that he is intent on rescuing us from that chaos, whether it's the chaos of sin wreaks havoc in our lives or our circumstances, whether it's saving us from ourselves. God reveals himself as one who seeks to rescue. For any Jew hearing this, that God reveals himself as the Word, they would recognize that this is an offer of salvation. The psalmist understood this. Psalm 107, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, in the chaos of their lives, and he saved them from their distress. He sent forth his word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. So let us give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for people. God reveals himself as the word, the one who enters into our chaos, the one who reveals himself even in the midst of chaos, giving us an opportunity to discover things about him that otherwise would have remained a mystery. And one of the things we discover is his deep love for us, to seek us, to save us, to rescue us. It's a message so compelling that John will want to put it in terms understandable to everyone. Of course, John inherited the Old Testament as a theological background, but he also spoke into the cultural world of the Mediterranean Empire. John, yes, he had the mind of a theologian, but ultimately he had the heart of an evangelist. He wanted to make sure that this message of Jesus was understood by the culture of his day. He makes that purpose very, very clear at the end of his gospel. These things were written to you that you may believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and believing that you might have life in his name. He was an evangelist. You know, the idea of the word is not only Jewish, deeply rooted in the Old Testament. It's something that existed all throughout the Greco-Roman world. It's kind of like how we use the word evolution today, or paradigm shift. Most of us probably have never read Charles Darwin's Origin of Species, and yet we use the word evolution all the time, in all sorts of contexts. It kind of has this cultural value. Most of us have never read Thomas Kuhn's Structure of Scientific Revolutions, and yet we use the word paradigm shift the phrase paradigm shift to indicate, well, something that requires a total change in the way we look at life. It's not just in the realm of science. We use it in friendship, relationships, all sorts of contexts. It has just value that's out there. Well, the word, logos in Greek, it was like evolution or paradigm shift. Everyone knew that it meant something, even if they didn't understand that the Stoics used it in a very particular way, or the Greek philosopher used it in another particular way. Even if they didn't understand those original writings, they understood that by evoking this word, the word, that it tapped into the instinct for finding order that makes sense of the chaos. It's a universal instinct. It's not just theological. Everyone, from the person as far away from Christ as you can imagine possible, everyone longs to have their life make sense. Everyone longs for that deep satisfaction that at the end of the day, that the work that they gave themselves to, well, it just makes sense. It makes sense of who they are and how they want to contribute. We all desire to just make sense. It's this universal instinct. And the gospel is the story, the ultimate story to make sense of our lives. And it's told with creativity and beauty in John. Maybe more than any other gospel. John not only has the eye of the historian, the mind of the theologian, the heart of an evangelist, he also has the artistry of a poet. Look how he uses the imagery here. Life, light and darkness. Bold uses of metaphor that we're going to see over and over again to tap into the deepest longings of the heart. And in this prologue, in the first 18 verses of John, you get this introduction into the story of Jesus. There are over a dozen references here packed into the prologue that he's going to unpack for the rest of the gospel. What does it mean that Jesus is the light? Or he is the life? Or he's the way and the truth? Specific phrases that he finds poetically weaving into this first section. I think the very form of this prologue, the poetry of it, says something about God. God is into beauty. That the strands of our lives that may look awfully ugly are in fact being woven together by God. That God is a heavenly artist who intends to weave together something beautiful. Of course, having the sensitivity of a poet doesn't mean that you're a softy. And John's gospel reveals the fiery soul of a prophet. Verse 5, the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. You know, the older version of the NIV, the version that we have typically in our pews, where they're not sent to the binders to be rebound, verse 5 reads this way. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. The newer version of the NIV, which is what we read this evening, says the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. Well, which one is it? Is it that the darkness is unable to comprehend the light? Or is it that the darkness is unable to conquer the light? And translations are pretty much split half and half between those two options. In fact, the Greek, well, it legitimately can be used with both meanings. And in fact, both meanings could make perfect sense in this passage. We are definitely going to see in the gospel how Jesus, the light of the world, appeared to bring salvation only to be rejected. Rejected by his own people, crucified by his enemies. It is, in fact, the case that darkness is unable to comprehend Jesus. It's why you can't argue people to come to Jesus. There's never going to be enough arguments that you can make to make sense of Jesus to someone else. Yes, you're to explain, but ultimately, you're to pray. Pray that the darkness would comprehend it. But I think there's a stronger case to be made here for the other interpretation. Because, in fact, John uses the word, the same word later in the account with the woman caught in adultery. In John chapter 8, the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught. The same word here for overcome or comprehend. Caught in adultery. There's a sense of her being grasped. And John also uses it in a context very similar to the opening. In John 12, the light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you, lest darkness catch you up. If this is the right reading, and I think it is, I think there's a reference here. A reference to the fact that darkness will not have the last word. Darkness representing evil is not going to have the last word. That there is a victory of Jesus over evil. That the dark day of the cross, when it most appeared that evil won, was in fact the day when the light of salvation shone in this world. And it's a prophetic word. Sin doesn't have the last word. Evil doesn't have the last word. Circumstances don't have the last word. It is, in fact, Jesus, the Word at the beginning, who is going to be the Word at the end. So as we start this exploration of John, as we see how our story, the story of our lives, work into the story revealed in Scripture, remember, we have one who has the last word. You know, during World War II in Holland, Corrie ten Boom, who actually preached here several decades ago, Corrie ten Boom and her family built this false wall in their house. It's devout Christians. They were compelled with the belief that what the Nazis were doing to the Jews was wrong. And they could not stand by as followers of Jesus and let that happen. So in their house, they built a false wall that became known as The Hiding Place, the title of her book, as well as a movie based on her lives. And so they would hide Jews in this secret room that she had created, her family had created. Then in February of 1944, when it looked like they might just make it through the war, a Dutch informant gave them away. And the Nazis came and took their entire family away. Corrie's father died in prison, as well as many other relatives. Corrie and her sister Betsy, with whom she shared the closest of relationships, were sent to the concentration camp at Ravensbrück. There they had this remarkable ministry to other prisoners that stood as a witness even to their tormentors. One of the most devastating experiences for Corrie was not the torture that she encountered, but the torment of seeing her beloved sister literally wither away before her eyes. Shortly before Betsy died, when she knew that the darkness of her death was overshadowing Corrie, she told Corrie, "There is no pit so deep that God is not deeper still." That line remained one of the favorite lines that Corrie repeated over and over again throughout her life. Undoubtedly, she probably spoke those words in the pulpit here when she preached. There is no pit so deep that God is not deeper still. There's no darkness so profound and thorough that God's love is not brighter. We are all going to be in a pit at some point. We're all going to feel that our lives, whether it is the pit of our sin, whether it's the pit of our circumstances, whether it's the pit of difficulties that we're encountering that we can only call satanic in our lives, we're all going to be in a pit at some point where darkness seeks to overshadow us. And the words of this prophet ought to ring in our ears. Darkness has not overcome it. As the band comes up to lead us in our offertory, I want to invite you not only to respond in the offering of your lives through the gifts that you would offer, but the offering of your life through the gift of time, reflection, through the gift of service. What is it that God would call you to this year? Do you need to be called to have the eye of the historian, to study Jesus, or to have the mind of the theologian? Not just to look at the Bible and, you know, flip through it, but to engage with it. Do you need to have the heart of an evangelist to see those around you as lost, in need of the gospel? Do you need to have the artistry of a poet, recognizing that God is at work in your lives, weaving it together? Do you need to have the soul of the prophet, that no matter what pit you might find yourselves in, that God's love is deeper still? He is the Word, and the darkness has not overcome it. Amen.